Well, good morning. I have seven grandchildren. My name is Grandma Lynn Snodgrass, the CEO of the Best Darn Chamber in the Pacific Northwest. I used to say in Oregon, but I've moved it up in 2017. So I'm a grandmother of seven grandchildren, and I have five grandsons. Grandson number second from the bottom, he's 6 years old. He got for Christmas a Taekwondo gift certificate, so he got to start Taekwondo. So he did that in January, one of the few days that he could actually get out because of the snow and the ice. And when he was done, he and his mom were walking out of the Taekwondo place, and he went, "I've been waiting for that my whole life." And sometimes I feel when we're in economic development, we get those great big, "I've been waiting for that for so long." Yeah, he's only six. He doesn't know what the whole life means. But that's what we got planned for you today. I want to thank our sponsors, first of all and foremost, Portland General Electric. John Maloney, where's John? There you are. John, thank you for your hard work all the month of January and December and maybe this week. Thank you. Portland General Electric. And Larry Schwartz is here too, and he is also a presenting sponsor with Riverview Community Bank. Larry is right there. Hi, Larry. And Larry's in charge of putting our programs together. So you like it, let him know. If you don't like it, let him know again. All right. So, and I also want to thank our education sponsors, Gresham Barlow School District. I didn't see anybody from that school district here, but thank you to our education sponsors and our media sponsor, MetroEast Community Media. Keith, thanks so much for what you're doing. You're double duting on today. Thank you so much. We have amazing business and leaders luncheons, and it's so amazing they actually replay them twice. So there's flyers on the tables as you leave. You can pick it up when you get to see this again and see if you really heard what you thought you heard, and you can listen to it again at a replay time. We would like to acknowledge our elected officials, and I saw Councilman Kirk French here, who is the president of the council this year. Thank you, Kurt, for coming. They only let you out? Nobody else could come today? Is that? Oh, is that right? Okay. Oh, the flu? Okay. Do you have it too? You want to Lysol that table? Okay. All right. Thank you. And I want to recognize our chamber board members. They do a lot of hard work on your behalf, behind the scenes and in front. So I'd like to introduce Warner Allen of Warren Allen LLP. Warner. And Jim Hathaway of Transamerica Financial Advisors. Jim, where's Jim? There's Jim over there. And he's sitting next to Sue Hughes of Resolutions. Sue, thank you for being here, Sue. Again, John Maloney, boy, you're just every place. John Maloney is a board member too. John Maloney of Portland General Electric. You can applaud him again, he needs it. And Shannon Stady with the City of Gresham. Shannon, thank you for being here and thanks for being a board member. We appreciate that. So we have a wonderful agenda planned for you today, and I was so, so pleased that when we had to cancel our January BLT with Bill Wyatt, that he had this date available as well. We're very fortunate and lucky that he was able to be here. If you listened or looked at your newsletter that you got at 10 o'clock today from the Best Darn Chamber in the Pacific Northwest, the Seeds to Plant says, "A leader is one who knows the way, goes the way, and shows the way." And Bill is definitely one of those, but I'm not going to introduce him. Whom I'm going to introduce is Brian Lesser with PDG Construction, who then is going to introduce our guest speaker today. Brian is the chairman of the Government Affairs Council. Brian, come on up.
Greetings. How are y'all? It's great that you can all be here. And I'm really happy to be able to talk about this gentleman for a few minutes, Bill Wyatt. All of you that have lived in this metro area for any period of time, you know his name for sure. You may not recognize him, or you may not know exactly what he does, but I've been hired and paid a huge sum of money to introduce him. So here's the down low on Bill. He has been the executive director of the Port of Portland since October of 2001. The Port of Portland operates 4 marine terminals, 3 general aviation airports, and the Port of Portland, Portland International Center. The port has nearly 800 employees and has an annual revenue of roughly $240 million. And the value of foreign trade moving through the port exceeds $11 billion, a pretty significant impact on the economy of our region. Prior to his appointment as the port's executive director, Mr. Wyatt served as the chief of staff to former Governor John Kitzhaber for 7 years, preceded by 6 years as president of the Oregon Business Council, and 5 years as executive director of the Association for Portland Progress, then Portland's Downtown Development Association. Mr. Wyatt also served as a state representative from the District of Astoria from 1974 to 1977. John Kitzhaber helped Wyatt land the job at the Port of Portland, where he has guided the expansion and the buffing up of PDX Airport, which has been named the nation's top airport for the last 4 years. Quite a remarkable achievement, actually. Mr. Wyatt also has overseen the purchase and the cleanup of one of Metro's area's largest pieces of industrial land. I'm told initially 800 acres, the Reynolds aluminum plant in Troutdale. It has been redeveloped into a 350-acre, I'm told, industrial park containing, as most of you know, the FedEx distribution center and 12 other industrial sites. Recently, a letter to Governor Brown has announced his retirement this June. So that makes today an even more interesting day for our business and leaders luncheon. Perhaps he'll tell us what's next on his already remarkable career agenda. Please welcome Mr. Bill Wyatt.
Thank you, Keith. Thank you very much. I just told him he earned his keep there. So, well, it's great to be here today. I was just asking Brooke Berglund here, who with the port and helps me with events like this. I said, now, is this our last one of these? And she said, no, we got snowed out of Hillsborough also. So that was Snowmageddon. I think this was Icemageddon. It's been a pretty unusual weather year. And the original purpose for us of getting out was to celebrate the Port of Portland's 125th anniversary, which was actually last year. So the weather has really played a role, and I am very pleased that I am able to be with you today and talk a little bit about the port, because of course we now have a great presence in your city, in Gresham, and we're extremely pleased with it. I'm going to be talking a little more about that as we get into this, but I thought I would just get into the presentation and give you a little sense about the history of the port, because it's remarkable. It says a lot about our region, and it has everything to do with why we are all here today. Not here having lunch today, but living here in this region. So I love this picture. This was actually taken in 1891. This is the Willamette River, not the Columbia. There was no significant commercial activity up above the confluence of the Willamette and the Columbia River at that time. And what you're looking at on the left-hand side of that picture is downtown Portland. And you can see here, right here, that's a steam-driven tugboat, in effect. The port actually owned one of those way back in the day. And these sail vessels, these clippers, used to be towed up the Columbia River to this location in downtown Portland. And the purpose, the reason why the Port of Portland was created back in 1891 by the Oregon Legislature was to construct a navigation channel from downtown Portland originally to the mouth of the Willamette River, which joined with the Columbia, and then ultimately from there to the Columbia River bar. And that's a function that we still provide. Today, the primary responsibility for maintaining that navigation channel belongs to the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. We have a pipeline dredge. It is the coolest toy you've ever seen. It is absolutely immense. It's about the size of the building here. It goes out for 6 months or so every year. It isn't self-propelled. There's a small Navy that travels with it, and it can pump that coarse-grained sand at the bottom of the navigation channel up to 2 miles, which it does regularly. And an average year, it'll dredge maybe 6 million cubic yards of material. Those of you who are in the construction business will have a sense about 6 million cubic yards. So it's quite a machine, but really central to the economy of that Portland metropolitan area, and even today, because without it, we wouldn't be able to maintain that navigation channel at its current depth of 43 feet. So it's quite a story, and because of that, because of the maintenance of the channel and the deepening over the years, Portland became a major trading center. And I would say that many of the characteristics that caused that to be are still reflected in the economy of our region. We're a heavily trade-dependent state in large measure because of where we are. In fact, William Clark, when he was going back, having been to my hometown of Astoria and headed back to report to President Jefferson, made a brief visit, spent the night down at what is now Terminal 4 on the Willamette River, where we import Toyotas, and pronounced in his journals that this would be the site of a major trading city. He was prescient enough in 1804 to see the landscape, to appreciate the rivers, having floated down from the Umatilla area to Astoria, actually, to the end, to have a sense for what could happen here. So that led to ultimately, you know, the construction of two transcontinental railroads, both the BN and the Union Pacific Railroad, two interstate freeways, an international airport, all of which combined to give this region a tremendous footprint in the international trade arena. And albeit what we're trading today in some respects is different, the impact of trade itself is not. And the port has been at the center of that for 125 years. Now this, I think, is the best picture of our region. It looks like it was taken from a drone above Sovi Island, and you're looking right here at these, basically the port facilities. Rivergate, that's what this is the largest industrial park in Oregon, and it's an immense employment center. This is actually an older photo. There isn't much green space left there because it's been completely developed. The green that you see here is largely the result of dredge material being placed there over the last 125 years from constructing the navigation channel. And in the 70s, when the Port of Portland, which didn't used to be in the maritime business, funny enough, was merged with the City of Portland's Commission on Public Docks, one of the things they started to do was to develop land that they themselves had created with this pipeline dredge. And it's been an enormously important part of our economic history here in Portland. And so you see downtown Portland is here. You can't quite see kind of where we are, but it's out here. Gresham Vista, Troutdale, the Troutdale Reynolds Industrial Park, PDX, West Hayden Island, which we own, and who knows, we'd love to develop someday. And then our marine terminals, 6, 5, 4, and 2. 1 and 3 went the way of wherever. They were closed many, many years ago. And I would say there's even a possibility of a Terminal 7 in this neighborhood. So tremendous amount of industrial activity that occurs. And the only things that we own that you can't really see here are the that are not somewhat visible, at least, are the Hillsborough Airport, which on most days of the week is Oregon's second busiest airport in terms of takeoff and landing activity, and next to it, the Brookwood Corporate Park. Otherwise, you get to see everything we do right here. The port is a unique creature among ports. There are many port districts in Oregon, but the Port of Portland is unique in that we are technically a municipal subdivision of the state of Oregon. And so our commission members, all represented here, are appointed by the governor. They serve for terms of 4 years, and on good behavior, typically are reappointed for a second term. And we haven't had any bad behavior yet. So I'm actually on my third set of port commissioners. And my third commission president represented here. It's a great group, and I think for our port, for Oregon, this has been a fantastic model. They approach what we do as business people, and that may seem obvious, but most ports have elected commissions, and so elected commissions bring obviously a political agenda, which is not necessarily inappropriate, but may not necessarily be in the best interest of the business that you run. And we'll get into the numbers in a minute, but the port is it's a publicly owned business. We get a little tiny property tax. Next time you get your property tax bill, you'll find it on there. It's the last one. It's very small from the three county metropolitan areas, and it represents less than 4% of our total revenues. So everything else we generate through terminal rents and landing fees and concessions and parking and then all kinds of odd things like wheelage that we charge to the railroads and wharfage and dockage and so on and so forth. So we have to make our own way, and that means having people who have an appreciation for business is extremely important to us. Jim Carter, our commission president, is the former general counsel of Nike. Tom Chamberlain is the current president of the Oregon AFL-CIO. Very important to us. A third of our employees are represented by unions that belong to the AFL-CIO. Bob Levy is a sheep rancher from Eastern Oregon, and that doesn't begin to describe him. He's an extraordinary guy with an amazing background, but a major client of the port terminals. Linda Pierce is the chief financial officer of the Tillamook Creamery Association, which is also a major consumer of port stuff. Michael Alexander is retired from what was Blue Cross and Blue Shield, now Regency, and from the Urban League of Portland, a really great mind for business. Alice Cooperl Comas is a lawyer with OHSU, a service provider to us, but also her legal skills are extremely important. Pat McDonald here is the head of human relations for all of Intel Corporation, a major consumer of port facilities. They fly their own little air force out of Hillsborough up and down the West Coast, 180,000 passengers a year, all Intel employees going to their various facilities. So engineers wake up in Hillsborough and fly to Chandler, Arizona and go to work and vice versa, because the Hillsborough Airport is right next to their facilities. Tom Ceruta, this is a great story. He is an American citizen now. When I believe Governor Kitzhaber appointed him to the commission, all of us had failed to note that he was actually not an American citizen, albeit he had lived here for 35 years. And this came out during the hearing, and he was really disappointed. He's had a long career in global business, and we thought he'd be a terrific asset. And he said, well, you know, I could become an American citizen. And I said, well, how hard would that be? He goes, no, it's easy. I've got a green card. I've had it for a million years. He became an American citizen in order to serve on our commission, which is really exceptional. And he's been a tremendous asset. And then Gary Young is the business agent for the IBEW, the electricians, and Electricians represent the single largest classification of Port of Portland employees, which just tells you a lot about what our people do. They're out there working on things all the time. So it's a great commission, strong, supportive, knowledgeable, engaged. And to be honest, they know their job and they know my job. And they let me do my job as long as I don't screw it up. And that's part of their job, is to make sure that that I'm doing what I'm supposed to be doing. So this is what our budget looks like, and it really comes in two pieces. On the left, the general fund is everything except for airports. So it's all the marine terminals, the industrial land, and you can see that the total revenue is around $90 million. And on the right, you can see the airport side. PDX is the only one of our airports that generates net revenue. Troutdale, in the last decade, we've had to feed. It's lost about $10 million over the course of that time. And Hillsborough, on an operating basis, is about even, but they can't generate enough for capital. So you want to put in a new runway or you want to do a major maintenance activity, we feed that. So if you park at Portland International Airport, thank you very much. You're helping support the Troutdale and Hillsborough airports. And it's a worthwhile trade because they provide a reliever function for PDX, for small general aviation activities that would be difficult for us to accommodate at PDX. Overall, I think this year we're expecting about $330 million of revenue. And on the airport side, we don't generate a profit. And this is a little hard for people to get, but the airlines pay for most of the operation at PDX. And our deal with them is we're only going to charge them as much as it costs to operate the airport. And if over the course of a year we overcharge them, they get a check back. Consequently, if we undercharge them, we get a check. And they sit down with us every single month and go through our entire line item budget and all the capital projects. And capital is not included here. Over the next 5 years, we will spend, just at the airport, about $2 billion on airport projects. All of that will be funded by the enterprise of the airport itself. So it's a good operating model. We have a 10-year airline agreement, which is very unusual. Most airports have a 3 to 5 year airline agreement, and we have a great relationship with the airlines, which is vital because we need to grow. When I started at the port, we had about 11 million passengers. This year, we're going to have 18 million passengers without any new capacity at all. And it is today, when I drove in, the fourth floor of the short-term garage was full. And this is Tuesday. That's not a good sign. Wednesday and Thursday are the big days of the week, and oftentimes we'll find both garages completely full. So we're expanding, we're adding gates, and excited. Overall impact, about 26,500 people work on property owned and operated by the Port of Portland. The airport alone, 10,000 people get up every single day and go to the airport and work. Pilots, flight attendants, ground service personnel, maintenance, concessions, port employees, although we're a very small part of that. So it's an immense concentration of employment. About $1.7 billion in a personal income. And nearly $5.7 billion in business revenue that's generated by our tenants. And they all combine to pay $172 million in local and state taxes. And I didn't break out here the property tax side of it, but for the about $9.5 million that you collectively help pay the Port of Portland every year in property taxes, we return something like $15 million in local property tax. So you're making an investment and it's paying off, and not everybody in local government gets to say that. Trade dependency, what I was talking about earlier, Oregon always ranks very high up on the list of most trade dependent states. And you can see here in 2015, about $20 billion in goods exported. That's not just through the Port of Portland, that's overall. and Oregon firms imported about 14.5 billion goods. So Oregon is, you know, this whole debate that's going on about trade right now, we're a net exporter in large measure. And that's very unique, I can tell you, in the United States. Most states are significant net importers. Nearly 500,000 people in Oregon have jobs that are directly dependent on trade-related businesses. And there are about 5,000 companies in Oregon who are exporting. There are companies who are exporting and may or may not know they're exporting, right? Just because of the diffuseness of the supply chain today, it's not always apparent. So PDX mentioned earlier, it is Oregon's only international airport and by far the largest, 18.3 million passengers last year, an 8.9% increase. And when we forecast growth, we usually use a number given to us by the FAA. And their number for us this coming year is, I think, about 3%. And I think we're going to be somewhere between 8 and 10%. We've seen a lot of growth. Now, I'd love to tell you that is exclusively the result of outstanding management, but that would probably be wrong. Growing airports are a sign of a very strong local economy, and airports around the country are really driven by the economic characteristics of the community they're in. And when the economy is strong, people are traveling, both for business and for pleasure. And I can tell you, because I've lived through both, when the economy is weak, people are not flying, and they're not parking at the airport, and they're not buying concessions. So these things do tend to go. In fact, a short-term parking garage is, I think, the best metric for an economic barometer in Oregon. If you track short-term parking revenues at our airport versus economic activity in Oregon, it's just like exactly the same. The lines always move in symmetry together. And we have 80 nonstop destinations now. That means a plane takes off in Portland and goes to where someone primarily wants to go. We operate what's called an O and D airport, origination and destination. Relatively few people fly to Portland and connect to go to somewhere else, although it's about 10%. Most people are coming here either because they live here or because they're coming here for business or for pleasure. They're not connecting. And so that's a very strong O&D network, and that is going to grow dramatically because Alaska Airlines is buying these smaller jets, these Embraer 175s. And unlike the Q400, the propeller planes they operate, the 175 gets up to an altitude that's a little more comfortable, it goes a little faster, and it goes quite a bit further, and it's a much more comfortable plane, and they're acquiring a lot of them, and that means we're going to open up, I'm sure, a whole series of new markets in the middle part of the country, places like Tulsa and Oklahoma City and Milwaukee, which we already serve, which a few years ago no one would ever have imagined being served directly out of Portland. And so that will continue this high percentage growth that we're experiencing. We do have some new international air cargo service. This is just a huge development for us because twice a week now, and soon it will be 3 days a week, a 747 arrives here. It actually connects up from LA, but this is an airline called Cathay Pacific. They're headquartered in Hong Kong. They're a very famous carrier owned by a British firm, and they have a major distribution operation in Hong Kong. So you think, well, what is it that is so valuable that draws a 747 here? These are very expensive to operate. And the principal cargo are air soles. The only thing that Nike itself makes are the little airbags that go into the bottom of the shoes that then need to go to their footwear factories throughout the world. And you think, well, why are they doing those here? And it's all about intellectual property. They want to preserve the intellectual property in those bags. It's a highly engineered product, and they're very afraid of letting that technology out of the country. The patents that have expired on various of their airbag products means that they can move that production closer to the manufacturing facilities as they've done, but they're coming up. Nike is one of the most prolific generators of intellectual property in our region, they and Intel. And so every week, about 50,000 pounds of airbags are flown from Portland to Hong Kong and then to many, many points beyond into China and Vietnam and Malaysia, Indonesia, and so forth. But while that plane is here, it also picks up other local cargoes. And that is particularly important for shippers for whom a day or two or three makes a very big difference. And the one thing that I think has not gotten much attention, not very many people have really gotten into this subject, but in this new age of internet shopping, Portland has become a global hub for internet acquisition and distribution. There are over 100 Chinese e-commerce companies located in and around the airport area. So you think about the shopper in Shanghai who wants to buy a Leatherman tool. Okay, also produced very close to here. The actual purchase occurs here in Portland, so they pay no sales tax. Trundles over to an air freight forwarder where it's packaged with lots of other things. Gets on this big 747, and a day and a half later, it's in Shanghai, which is pretty remarkable if you think about the global supply chain. So a lot of internet commerce activity. This is all outgoing. It's all export, which is tremendous. Spring, I'm told, is right around the corner. We'll see about that. We're going to have a lot of fresh fruit going from our region to Asia. Things like cherries, which are huge, and pears, probably some apples, blueberries, huge exports. A lot of fresh and frozen fish, live crab. So all of these things will take advantage of this faster supply chain. And yes, once again, each of the last 4 years, PDX has been named the best airport in the country, 7 out of the last 11. We're not just proud of that, we consider it to be our mission. This is an airport that is used primarily by people who live here. So our neighbors, our friends, our employees are our customers. So we treat PDX like a piece of the civic living room furniture, from the new carpet, very controversial, to the way that we design new facilities, the concessions that we provide, the requirement that we have on our concessionaires that they charge street prices. You're not going to pay more for that book at Powell's at the airport than you are at Powell's downtown and vice versa. So we generate more per square foot and more per passenger in concessions revenue than almost any airport in the United States. And I think a large part of that is people are willing to spend more if they feel like they're not going to get gouged. Or they'll come to the airport early and have a meal because they're not going to get killed. And by the way, they got great choices. And we're basically in the process of tripling the size of our concessions footprint at the airport based just on the growth and the demand for that. And so if you get out there, take a look around. It's really very exciting. We've expanded a lot of our international service. Safe to say that when I started at the airport, Portland International Airport was international by virtue of one daily nonstop between Portland and Vancouver, British Columbia. And we considered the Canadians to be a foreign country, so we took it. But that was not satisfactory, particularly for the business community. I think one of the very first meetings I had after I got the job was with the executive committee of the American Electronics Association, and they said, we got to have international service, got to go to Asia, got to go to Europe, because we have people who are doing this twice a month. And for them to connect, particularly with the new security regimes after 9/11, means you're taking weekends away from our employees by not having nonstop international air service. And so we went out and tested the market, and we said to them, okay, we think they're, you know, we're really on the edge of being big enough, but here's the only way it's going to work, and that is you all, you Nike, you Intel, you Daimler, you whoever, you have to commit to using whichever carrier we bring here. And they hemmed and hawed for a little while, and then we created something called the Travel Bank, into which they began depositing very large checks, and it could only be used at the discretion of a nonstop carrier that would select Portland for the international travel of the employees of those companies. And the very first recruitment was with Lufthansa. It was European. And you know, they've gone, and Delta's in Amsterdam now. That's a longer story. But the important point is, I had the great pleasure of going to Frankfurt with a large crew and handing them a check for $10 million, which was the amount that companies in this region invested. That's how important they thought it was to have nonstop international air service, and that is why it's here today. It's great for those of us who love to go to Europe for vacation, but if you're paying $750 in the back of the plane, you're really not paying your gas bill. It's those, you know, $5,000 and $6,000 seats up in the front who are paying the price, and that's why the carriers are here. But since they're here, we all get to take advantage of that. So originally Northwest Airlines came in next to Tokyo and then to Amsterdam, both big centers of activity for them. Delta bought them. Lufthansa left, and the rest is sort of history. We now have a service to Reykjavik, and you think, how many people are going to Reykjavik? Almost none. Iceland Air operates a big hub out of Reykjavik. It's a low-cost carrier. They offer a great deal, which is you can go, if you're going to go to Rome on Iceland Air, you can stop in Reykjavik for 4 days. Up to 4 days, I think it is, and then move on. And I've done that. We went over to kind of finish the deal with them. It's spectacular. It's just an amazing country. And then Condor Airlines to Frankfurt. These are both seasonal services. They don't go in the dead of the winter, but they're here all summer. And of course, Alaska now to various points in Mexico, beach markets. And Volaris Airlines to Guadalajara. So we now, I think next year, there will be days of the week when we'll have 12 daily departures to various international locations, and that's going to expand. It's an immensely important economic contribution to the region. And it's two-way. You can go anywhere in our region now and hear the sound of foreign voices being spoken. European languages, Asian languages, Chinese, and so forth. And we're just going to see more of that. And you know, it's a large part of why I have so much passion for this work. I think that's one of the most important things we can be doing in the world is getting on this pipeline, going back and forth, meeting people, learning, et cetera. We had a small increase in air cargo activity. This number will grow considerably next year because we'll have had a full year of Cathay Pacific. On the marine side, the auto business, we're the largest auto export gateway in the West Coast, and I think we're the second largest auto import. If you own a Toyota, you own a Hyundai, you own a Honda, I'd be willing to bet you that it came through the Port of Portland. We're now exporting Ford automobiles, made in Michigan, railed out here to both South Korea and to China. And these are not Ford Fusions. They're Lincoln Navigators. They're Ford F-150s. Apparently, there's a big market growing in China for pickup trucks. But it's extraordinary. Ford will export 50,000 automobiles from the Port of Portland this year. And the great thing is, for a variety of reasons, the Chinese won't allow these vehicles to be processed in China, meaning the buyer wants a Bose stereo system and a sunroof and whatever else. So it happens at our facility. Teamster union jobs are putting in the Bose stereo system or the sunroof or whatever it is. Several hundred jobs associated with this activity. Mineral bulks. Minerals, in our case, are soda ash used in the manufacture of glass, potash, which is a fertilizing agent. They have similar properties, and they all are mined about a mile below the surface of the earth, and they're exported from the Port of Portland to points all over the world. The potash business in particular is highly lucrative because it allows companies that are feeding these vastly growing middle classes a way to really improve the efficiency of their land, and these are naturally occurring fertilizers. So really a growing business. Grain, both wheat and corn and soybeans, 4.5 million tons. And then of course the dredge Oregon I mentioned earlier. Containers is sort of a sad story, although I have recent signs for optimism, and you'll be, I'll just say this, you'll be reading about this in a week or so. And we operate the smallest container terminal. We don't actually operate it ourselves, but it's the smallest container terminal on the west coast of the United States. It's 107 miles up a channel-constrained river, and the container industry, generally speaking, has gone to massive vessels, most of which will not operate in the Columbia River ever. They're just too big. And we had a pretty good little business here, primarily export-oriented, and owing to a real conflict with the International Longshore Warehousemen's Union, the productivity got so low the terminal operator just couldn't make any money, and the carriers left. And our big carrier, Hanjin, since that time, has also liquidated. They don't exist anymore. And that is a statement about what's happening behind the curtains in the container industry. It is a very challenging business. As I said, there are some real signs and reasons for optimism here, and I'm hopeful, but if everything was working the way it should be, it's a challenging business. The industrial properties, this is a happy story. We got into the industrial land business because we owned a pipeline dredge, which made a lot of industrial land. And then all of a sudden, during my time, we started running out, and we had a choice to make. Do we just sell what we've got and forget about it, or is there a role for us in the region? And we finally decided we think there's a role for an organization devoted to putting difficult industrial land sites on the market, because the good sites are all being chased after by the commercial real estate industry. They don't need us. And the very first thing we did was look at the shuttered Reynolds aluminum plant, which had been purchased by Alcoa, as it turns out, primarily for the brand name Reynolds, Reynolds Wrap. It was a very old plant. They hadn't invested in a long time, and the aluminum industry generally has not done well in the U.S. But it was also a Superfund site, and there were no private developers who were going to step forward and develop that property. So we went to Alcoa, and to their everlasting credit, they said, we'll clean it up, and we'll sell it to you, and you do what you can to convert this into industrial land. And Reynolds, for all of the time that they owned this plant, had been very effective in Salem at preventing their property from being annexed into the city of Troutdale so that they wouldn't pay city property taxes. So we went to the city of Troutdale and said, we'd like to increase the land mass of your community by a third, which is about what it is. And they were obviously pretty enthusiastic about that. We had a couple of false starts, but what's happened since then has been incredible. The EPA gave us the annual award as the best brownfield redevelopment in the country. It is the largest brownfield redevelopment in state history. There are overall pretty close to 300 developable acres there. The very first parcel that we sold was to FedEx for their Northwest Area Ground Facility. And you may have noticed at our last commission meeting, we approved the sale of a large parcel, 73 acres, to Trammell Crow, a major commercial or real estate developer whose client is Amazon. They're going to put in a 2 million square foot fulfillment center. And I'm telling you, this is not a fulfillment center that has 10,000 people walking around grabbing things off of shelves. It is completely automated. But at the same time, they say they'll have 1,000 employees. Now, that's interesting because we looked at their same footprint up in Kent, Washington, and they have 2,500 employees. And not surprisingly, that's how many parking spaces they're building. So this property, the Troutdale Reynolds Industrial Property, which when Reynolds had it at its peak, employed 700 people, is going to have, by the time all is said and done, pretty close to 4,000 employees, an immense contribution to the tax base of the county, of the school districts involved, and to the city of Troutdale. And we're really pleased to be involved in it, and it requires an institution like the port to be able to do this, because no private entities were willing to take that kind of risk. You can see Gresham Vista here, and I'm going to talk about that in a moment. Portland International Center, it's kind of where IKEA is and all of those shops. We built that, or we leased that on a very long-term basis originally to Bechtel Corporation so that they would build the light rail connection from Gateway to the airport, which they did. And it's been a fantastic success. Swan Island is sort of the original property owned by the port. And it used to be an island, of course. It's where the shipyard was during the Second World War, and it is fully developed. Daimler has a major operation there, many others as well. All right, Gresham Vista. So we're looking past the Troutdale Reynolds Industrial Park, and we thought, what's next? And, you know, we were actually approached by the city of Gresham. And they had been frustrated by this property because LSI bought it and not long thereafter sold the manufacturing facility to ON Semiconductor, who had no interest in expanding. And LSI didn't really know how to develop the property, and it's just not their expertise. They're in the chip business, not in the land business. And the pitch to us was, why don't you buy it and do what needs to be done to parcelize it and, you know, put the infrastructure in, and just as you've done down in Troutdale. And so this was not a complicated decision for us, because it's a nice, you know, you can see the dimensions of the property. It's a little more complicated than a flat map like this shows, but not that much. And so we said, fine, and we went to LSI, and it was really a pretty straightforward proposition. And I'll tell you, the thing that gave us more confidence than anything else was the full court press from the city of Gresham. And this has been a partnership in every sense of the word. Everybody's shoulder is to the wheel. I mean, if this were easy, it would have been done a long time ago by some private developer. It's not easy. And the relationship has been fantastic. Mayor Bemis is always available at the other end of the phone, as am I. Our staffs work together hand in glove. We've invested pretty close to $30 million. The city has invested quite a bit in infrastructure. And we basically have really two parcels left. Subaru has this is actually a national facility here. This is where they receive all of their international cargo and then send it out to their distribution facilities around the United States. Spec Development is, that's a name of a person, by the way. He's a former tight end for the Oregon Ducks back in my day. He's he's now a big industrial real estate developer in the region. And the advantage of this, it is a spec, as in speculative development. He did not have any clients when he built it, is that he has a whole network of potential tenants that we don't necessarily have. And so it's a nice mix. Subaru came directly to us, but Greg and his team no doubt will fill this with some really high quality tenants. And then Trammell Crow has just taken this site down, and they're gonna do something similar. They're a national big time firm, and will also be great at recruiting. And who knows, I think a large part of the market for both of those could well be local companies who want to expand and don't have any other opportunities, and but for this might leave the region. And then Lot 5 is sort of it's the big prize out here. It's contiguous, it's square, and we're kind of holding it a little bit to see if we can really find a high-quality tenant. I went out to the Subaru ribbon cutting the other day. It's a spectacular facility. I really like the way they've done it. It's a challenge, as you know. I mean, it's sitting amidst a big residential neighborhood, but it feels like it works pretty well to me, and if it doesn't, I'm sure we'll hear about it. And this is the Subaru facility, which I have to say, the first time I drove by it after it was actually up and there were trucks parked there, I thought, whoa, it's big. It's really big. So international containers come in one side and 53-foot domestic trucks go out the other. It's an amazing operation, and nothing sits in that warehouse for very long. I mean, it comes in, gets parcelized, sorted out into a truck, and it's gone. It's always moving. And you can see the numbers here in total. Excuse me? It's about 500,000 square feet, I think. I'm looking at the troops here. 600,000 square feet, yeah. So take that back to the Amazon facility at 2 million square feet. That's a double decker, but wow, that's going to be big, very big. Investing in Oregon's future, you know, we didn't buy, oftentimes we buy your lunch, and so that's what you have to, the price you have to pay is my little pitch on this subject. This is all about transportation. This session of the Oregon legislature, many of the leaders, the governor, have said they really want to get a transportation bill out this session. It's important because that happens about once a decade, just in terms of the appetite of political leaders and of citizens to think about it, because it always involves something like a gas tax increase or a vehicle registration fee increase or whatever, and you can only do that so often. And so when you've got a little momentum to do something like that, it's really important to take advantage of that. And I noticed on the way out here, I'm sure you're noticing it too, it's a good metaphor. The streets got pretty well hammered by the ice and snow events. I live in the Pearl District, and it's a bomb craters you're driving through down there. And it's just a metaphor, and we don't really have the resources to repair adequately. That's just maintenance. But we also have tremendous needs in expanding our infrastructure. You know, people say, I get this all the time, our office is at the airport. In fact, I'll show you where it is here. It's right up there. That's my office. And yeah, it's a pretty good little view, believe me. And people go, well, how do you go home? How do you get downtown? I say, oh, it's simple. I go to the edge of my desk, I get my field glasses out, and I look at the 205 bridge. And it tells me all I need to know about how I'm going to get home. Because both bridges, the I-5 bridge, the 205 bridges, are just parking lots beginning at about 3, and if there's an accident, at about noon. And it is... it's an immense burden to business, let alone those of you who are trying to get back and forth or you know, do a chore or get your kids to school or whatever it is. And we've not made the kind of transportation improvements that we need to. Now, one telling sign to me that the public is beginning to really appreciate the importance of this is one of these sessions we did 3 weeks ago or so in Tillamook. It was fantastic. We went out to the old airfield there, and it turned out about this size in Tillamook. And so I give him this pitch at the end, and a guy stands up. He's a trucker. His brother is a dairy farmer, and they're members of the Creamery Association. And he says, yeah, okay, well, you can get us a little money down here, and we'll fill some potholes. He said, but the problems are not in Tillamook. They're in Portland. You got to fix the Rose Garden. You got to fix the I-5 bridge. These choke points are killing us, because that is our access to market. And in their case, they're actually going to Boardman in many cases. They have a big facility in Boardman, and they're going back and forth. So it used to be I could do a truck turn in a day, Tillamook, Boardman, and back again. He said, can't even think about that. Our truck driver, because of the hours of service regulation, now spends a night in Boardman and comes back. He's, you know, double the cost because of the Portland area congestion. And the Rose Garden is boy, right in the middle of it. And so that's my pitch to you. This chambers are going to be very important in this. Legislators, they're going to be looking at the business community to see what's your attitude about this. You know, the unions and the lefties, they're for any tax increase. I put myself in that category. I'll vote for anything. I've done it for a long time. But the key is the business community really is going to be the key here. And so your members are, I can guarantee you, they're going to check in. How do you feel about this? And you'll get, I know, a lot more information as the session proceeds. But without that, it's going to be a challenge. You have to get 3/5 of both the House and the Senate to vote in favor. And that's a challenge all by itself. But if you don't have the larger coalition built out there, it'll get referred. And in the history of our state, no gas tax increase has ever been supported by the voters. So you've got to get over that bar as well, something that feels okay to people so that it's not referred, so the major stakeholders aren't out there gathering signatures. It's a huge challenge, and the business community, in my opinion, really holds the key. So with that, I would say thank you, and I would be more than happy to entertain any questions or take any comments that you might have. Thank you.
So, questions? Okay. Oh, Marty. Marty. Did you have lunch, Marty?
No.
You were looking for leftovers?
I was going through all the potholes.
Oh, you're going through all the potholes?
Risking your life.
Marty is the new executive director?
Yeah, CEO.
CEO? You're a CEO too?
Yeah.
We're CEOs together of MetroEast Community Media. So,
oh,
Marty?
Great. Good.
I've got the van that Keith was looking for this morning. Sorry, Keith. I was working in Portland, and then they rerouted me the back way. But I was just curious, one question and one statement. One question was, I'm curious, do you have any idea what the economic impact of the carpet was, the selling of it? I thought that was the most clever thing in the world, that the carpet got sold to other people to then you know, my daughter was buying stuff in Ohio.
Incredible.
She was so much missing the carpet. And I was just curious if you had any anecdotes about how that happened. And then just as a small statement, one of the short films that we made, MetroEast Community Media, is going to be at the new theater at the airport.
Great.
And you may want to talk about that.
Hollywood Theater, great. So I thought I would
share that.
First movie theater in U.S. airport history, Hollywood Theater. They approached us. We're basically giving them the space for free. But it's just a great passenger asset, particularly for people whose plane is late or canceled or, you know, whatever. It'll be very fun. And I think it's also going to be great for the local filmmaking community because it's shorts. You know, you're not going to put on a 4-hour epic there. So there'll be, and shorts can be done on kind of a, you know, a sort of a garage film basis. And so I'm really excited about it. It's beautiful too. The sign is a replica of the actual Hollywood sign. The carpet. Yeah, you know, who knew?
I like the new carpet, by the way.
Yeah, well, good. You know, the airport carpet, it's 14 acres of carpet. It's a lot, you know, more than most of us buy. And it's 25 years old. The old carpet was 25 years old. And I'm telling you, even though it had a fan club, it looked it. And we had run out of patch material because you buy a carpet, you buy 14 acres, you're actually buying about 30. And you store it and, you know, as needs require. So this is a huge and very expensive project. It was a $15 million project. So this is something you have to plan way in advance because you don't like close the airport for 8 days to put new carpet in, you know, and you do it at night. And so when word first started leaking out that we were going to replace the airport carpet, a local guy and a fan of the carpet and the carpet design put up a Facebook page. And this, it just exploded. It had its own Facebook page, its own Twitter feed. And he is the one who popularized this idea of coming to the airport and taking a picture of your feet and tweeting it or putting it on Facebook, and people still do it today. We have a couple of spots in the airport where there are patches of the old carpet, so if that's what you want to do, you can go over there. People do it all the time. I had about 300 2-foot square things made so we could just give them out to people. I was just back in Washington, D.C. last week. Every one of our members of Congress has one of those sewn into their carpet as you walk into their office with a little storyboard about what it is. And I was in there in, I think, Suzanne Bonamici's office, and I'm looking at this kind of stunned by the whole thing. And somebody comes up to you and says, "You're the carpet guy. Have you got any left?" You know? And we, you know, it's interesting. We discovered, well, I'm going to tell you one other story about the design of the carpet. You just Google it and you'll see what it looks like because it's famous. But not many people really know the story. And so back when the Oregon Marketplace was developed, where all the original shops were in the middle, the architectural firm, Art Schleining was his name, got the contract to do all of the design. And at the same time, the port was going to do new carpet, because we had old carpet. We also had some linoleum, and I mean, it was pretty grody. And he walked into the radar center at the airport. Most people think the air traffic control tower controls planes in the air. No, they control planes on the ground. That's why they're so high. They have to see them. There's a dark series of rooms in there with the big old cathode ray tubes, literally. And he walked in. It's very dark, big screen, and he saw this pattern of lights on one of the screens, and he goes, "That's it." And he took a picture of it. And the lights were the runway lights for the runways that existed at that time, which are slightly different than they are today. And so when you look at that carpet, you're looking at the way the airport would have looked to an air traffic controller back in 1982 or so, which I think is just it's a great, lovely story. And we have preserved lots of pieces of the carpet around and about. But then Made in Oregon, everybody got into the game. We owned the copyright, and we had a very heartrending moment or two. Should we get into this business? Are we going to exercise our and no. You know, let the good times roll. And people have had a great time with it. It's been fantastic. This got, you know, we go to Europe, meet with the airlines, we take carpet patches, and they all know about it. So it's been great. And, you know, just one of those moments that you never count on, nobody could have dreamed of, and you just got to learn to go with the flow and make it work. Yeah.
Great story. Another question? Larry?
Well, I'm a lucky recipient of one of those pieces of carpeting.
Oh, great, great.
Question, you're going into retirement, or at least another phase of life. What's the process that is being taken to find your replacement? And lastly, thank you for having the direct flights to Cabo. My family appreciates that.
You are so welcome. My process began about 4 years ago or so. I was presenting to our commission officers the port's succession planning process for our employees, which is fairly elaborate. And, you know, you want to make sure you have people trained so that they can move up the ladder and not have too much knowledge, you know, or intellect walk out the door and be without. And one of the commissioners looked at me and said, "What about you?" And I said, "Well, I work for you. I'm the only port employee who works for the commission directly. Everybody else works through me or, you know, on up the ladder." And they said, "Well, what happens when you retire?" Now, keep in mind, this commission that you're seeing here has never hired an executive director before. And I said, "Well, it's pretty simple. I'll walk in, I'll give you enough notice, and then I'll say goodbye." And they said, "Well, that's not what we're wanting. That's the way it's always worked." And they said, first of all, we'd like to have at least an opportunity for an internal succession. Even though we'll do a search and everything, we'd love to be able to seamlessly move ahead. Because many times, I can tell you, I'm the longest tenured major West Coast port director by about 12 years. These are tough jobs, and people don't last very long, and it's disruptive. And so they wanted a process in place that would help avoid that. So I'm not selecting the next executive director, but I helped him with this, created a position, because there was nobody inside the organization at that time who would have fit the bill. So created a position, did my own little search, hired somebody who used to work for me. Lynn knows him. He worked in the governor's office, but he went away. He left us, went to graduate school, went to work for British Petroleum, and lived all over the world. Came back, was John Kitzhaber's chief of staff for about 3 years, and then I hired him to be my deputy. So he's a candidate. The commission has created a process. They have a citizen advisory committee. They will sort through the initial resumes. The commission has, or the port for the commission, has hired a professional recruiting firm, McDermott and Bull, and I think you can access all of this on our website. Is that right? We did a public outreach on qualifications and, you know, thoughts that people might have about the qualities and characteristics that they'd like to see, and got a lot of feedback, and we've incorporated that, the commission has. So McDermott and Bull is out actively right now seeking candidates for the job. And I think by sort of the middle of next month, this advisory committee will start sorting through all of those. And this will wind up ultimately with the commission itself making a selection either in May or in July. June is problematic for a variety of reasons. These are always challenging. When I was hired, it was like the gong show. I mean, it was, everything was wide open, all the interviews, everything, which is so constraining and limiting because there are a lot of questions you want to ask people that you'd never ask them out loud in a public setting, on the one hand. On the other hand, you do want people to feel like they've had the ability to affect the process. And so I think the commission president, Jim Carter, who's running all of this, has done a pretty good job of trying to strike that balance. Now, I think Curtis, to be blunt with you, I think he's got a really good chance here because this is an interesting job. If it were just an airport, man, there are a lot of people out there who you'd go talk to about coming to Portland to run our airport, and it would be an easy thing to do because it'd be very popular. If it were just a seaport, you could go to all kinds of places and find folks like that. If it were just an amalgam of industrial lands, you'd go somewhere else for that. But the reality is you got all three of those things, and you're not going to find anybody who brings lots of expertise in all of those areas. And then you layer on top of that, about half the job is doing this, or it's going down to Salem, or it's going back to Washington, D.C. You, executive director, you are the face of the organization. And it's going to be challenging, in my opinion, for somebody from Boston, which would be a location where I think you could see some candidates, to come out and satisfy the commission that they're going to do that latter part as well as everything else. But it could happen. You never know. I was stunned when I saw the range of candidates that applied when I was in this process, so it could happen.
Is it just the commission then that hires?
Yes.
Does the governor have anything to say?
Well, it's funny when you introduced me, you said the governor. I had wanted him to use his influence very badly, and wasn't.
I got that online,
yeah.
So it must have been true.
I was, well, from Willamette Week. You're reading Willamette Week, Lynn. That's where I was.
Yes, my favorite paper.
I was hoping for that. And I think, it's always sensitive. The governor appoints the commissioners and is the chief executive officer of the state. So you'd say, yeah, they ought to have an interest. And if they have if they have somebody they like, they ought to be able to weigh in. But these commissions are independent. And in the case of the port commissioners, they basically can't be fired. They cannot be reappointed, but they can't really be fired except for gross malfeasance. And then the governor actually has to go to the circuit court. This is like a 100-year-old statute. The circuit court in Multnomah County file papers. And so there is an air of independence. And, you know, governors have to always manage that. This governor, I think, is very satisfied with the process that the commission has set up. So I think she's going to let it run its course, and I think it'll be okay.
Another question, Brian, and then John.
I'm jumping John?
Thank you. With Amazon coming to Troutdale and FedEx already there and so forth, and then the proposed changes to the Troutdale airport, physical changes and so forth, what's the future of that airport?
You know, we just finished a master plan for the airport, and we do these master plans every 6 or 8 years, I think. I don't know if, I think we've master planned airport 10 years? Okay, 10 years, I'm told. And we did this master plan largely because of the development that was occurring on the trip site. You know, what's the impact and what should we know? But the other reason we did it is that we were facing, and we are still facing, a major maintenance of the principal runway, the only runway at Troutdale. And the FAA said to us, well, it's too wide and it's too long for the amount of business that you have. And so we won't pay airport improvement funds for the maintenance of the existing runway. And you know, you got to appreciate the FAA, there are many FAAs. This FAA is telling us we're not going to pay for a runway of that size. The other regulatory side of the FAA says, oh, you think you're going to shorten the runway? Oh, no, no, you're not going to do that. So you've got to sort all of that out. But in essence, that's where all this started, because the existing runway configuration is very old, and the nature of general aviation has changed dramatically over that time. And so we put together a citizen advisory committee, which advised the port, in effect, in the development of the master plan. And so the runway, I want to get my dimensions right, but I think we're going down to 4,000 feet from 5,000 feet. And that is sufficient to handle anything except for mid and larger sized business jets. And the big argument really, and there was an argument about this, is that, well, you're really constraining the future of the airport if we can't do the big business jets. Well, the Troutdale Airport has had the capacity, had the ability to service larger business jets for a long time, and they just haven't come. And that's in part because 6 miles down the road is PDX, which has an unbelievable business aviation private terminal. In fact, a brand new one is going to be opening in about a week and a half, I think it is. And so that was the judgment at the end of the day. For flight training, which is happening there now, Hillsborough Aviation, and for the typical sort of general aviation, single engine, some double engine, piston aircraft, Troutdale's a great location if it's convenient, you know, for people. But that's also not a growing business. You know, the single engine piston driven aircraft, most of those planes are very, very old. There are very few manufacturers continuing to make them. And by the way, most of the pilots who are flying them, they kind of look like me. They're getting older. Cessna 172, I don't think it's been built since probably 1977 or 8, so it's an old plane. So it'll continue to have a function, and who knows with Amazon there, you know, people, drones, are they gonna do drones? Who knows? And I would say I wouldn't write off drones. A place like Troutdale, and I don't mean just for Amazon, but just the drone business generally, that is a business to keep your eye on. It is a potentially enormous economic sector that is a little hard to understand, but is really growing. So it's got a future, but a somewhat limited future.
Yes, I want to circle back to this transportation issue for a minute, because I think it's probably one of the most critical issues we've got in the region. In light of budget discussions that are going on in our state legislature, we know there's large shortfalls in the K-12 budget. Community colleges are struggling. Universities trying to get more. Everybody's trying to get more money. I'm in the construction business, and I talk to people whose boots are on the ground, whose trucks and vans and stuff are rolling day in and day out across the region. And even small contractors now are starting to recognize that their crews can only do about two-thirds of the assignments that they were able to do 5 years ago. This is having huge impact. So my question is there Echo Northwest, somebody doing a regional study that can be used to reinforce the dialogue, not just at the state level, but at a federal level, for transportation dollars.
So the Portland Business Alliance, the Port of Portland, and other groups participated in, we've done this twice now, something called the Cost of Congestion Study. And it looks exactly at things like that. You know, one of my favorite examples, think about FedEx here. They have a local distribution function out of here, little step vans. And so my guess is that those step vans are a lot less efficient today than they were 5 years ago when they opened. So what's the solution for FedEx? Buy more vans. Oh, more congestion. I mean, that's literally what's happening for the distribution business in particular, Amazon Prime. You know, their job is to get it there on time. And if it's not there on time, they're going to buy more trucks, and because they know that more people are sitting in traffic, and that will contribute to congestion. This study, and I don't have it all on the top of my head, but actually, if you trade cards with Brooke, we'll get you a copy of it because we have a lot of them. Raise your hand. There we go. And it's a great study because it does exactly that. It looks at what congestion costs our economy. And it's, you know, it's just, it's one of the voices that adds to this debate. But the story I told you about Tillamook, the significant thing about that is that historically, when this subject would come up, people in rural areas, I represented a rural area, their beginning point of the conversation was, we are sick and tired of paying gas taxes down here in Astoria that's just going up to Portland. And here's the reality, it goes the other way around. You all are sending gas tax dollars to the rural areas of the state by a large order of magnitude. But now, and we after the Tillamook meeting, we went to Astoria the next day, and I heard the very same thing. People are saying, yeah, we've got some issues around here, but nothing like those problems in Portland and what they're meaning for us and what it does to us economically. And that is a change in the statewide dialogue that I think is going to be hugely beneficial. We've got a guy going out to Ontario, going to be meeting with State Representative Cliff Bentz, Ontario, 5 miles from Idaho. And he was one of the leaders of the Columbia River Crossing coalition to get that happening because he recognized what a roadblock that was for his agricultural constituents. So I'm hopeful, and the other thing is to try and keep it away from the other dialogues that are going on around the state shortfall. These are separate, discrete resources. You cannot raise the gas tax and spend it for health care, for example, because we have a constitutional provision that says anything you raise in taxes that looks anything like a car or anything that a car touches goes into the transportation trust fund. So the hope, I think, is to keep the dialogue focused on that. I think we're in a good state. The Speaker, the President of the Senate, and the Governor are all really committed to this and talking about it. That's incredibly important. So I'm hopeful, but I've also been around, you know, it's not my first rodeo, so it's going to be a challenge.
Sue has last question.
Okay, great.
Well, pressure's on. So I'm going to just circle back to the Gresham Vista Park.
Yeah.
Just being a homeowner near that area, I've really watched it, you know, build up. I mean, those walls, they must be building those like right on site, right? Those kind of
tilt-ups. Yeah,
tilt-ups.
Pretty amazing.
Wow. Yeah, it's amazing. Is that all going to be industrial? Are you only selling out the industrial, or is there going to be a neighborhood or anything that makes that area not look so bleak?
Well,
Shannon?
Let me see. How can I make you happy here? Yeah, exactly. It's beautiful.
I welcome business.
Yeah.
I really do. But.
Well, the property is zoned industrial. They're not all going to look like the Subaru building. That's a big building. The spec building will be a little smaller, and the Trammell Crow one. And then there is a parcel. I don't have quite all the address, but where one of these days you could see like a grocery store, or there's a commercial property that is just not suited for industrial development. But I guess I'll just have
it's
to say
industrial.
It's all industrial.
And it's going to be beautiful.
And it's going to be, it is beautiful already. Yeah, 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 yeah. Great. Thank you very much. Yeah.
Thanks a lot.
I was in the Capitol as the speaker. Bill was there. He was the gatekeeper to the Gov. And I always had a very fun time talking for a long time to Bill until he let me through the gate. And I so appreciate that. You're such a statesman. We appreciate their time. And thanks for coming again. And Brooke, thank you. Steve, thank you for being here as well. And thank you to Portland General Electric. There will not be a snowstorm this week. It's on good authority. I've got that. And Riverview Community Bank, Gresham Barlow School District, and MetroEast Community Media. A couple of things I'd like to tell you. We will not have the BLT in March under normal circumstances, and not because of weather, but because we are co-hosting the State of the City again this year for the mayor. It will not be at this location, but you can register online. It's going to be the day after we normally have this meeting, so please, all of you, come. This is going to be a great and wonderful time again. The mayor is an amazing visionary, as you saw. Good partners all over the region, so be sure and put that on your calendar. Also want to talk to you just a second about Tri-Local. Tri-Local happens once a month. We celebrate a business, Tri-Local, you know, buy local, the whole local thing. Well, this is our annual Tri-Local cook-off, and it's called the Battle of the Ages. We've got a couple that are the oldies, but don't tell them. They don't know that. And we've got some millennials. We've got people a little bit younger than me. And then we have a 7- and 8-year-old. And they're all cooking. They're all competing. One is a professional chef. So come to Riggleman's and celebrate our Battle of the Ages Tri-Local. That's next Tuesday. With that, you get a free trip to Hawaii if you fill out your brochure there, your little... what's it called? Critique? Yeah. And the port is going to send you on one of those nonstop flights. So we want to thank you for doing that as a going away gift. Bill will make sure that you're up front in those $7,000 seats. All of that is a lie. But please fill it out so that we can provide you with a better opportunity next time. Bill, a round of applause for Bill Wyatt one more time. Thank you so much. And for the good of the order, you're dismissed. Thanks for coming.